Thank you. That concludes the debate on independent investigation into the First Minister and Deputy First Minister. It's time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of business motion 11260 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And moved.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak on the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 11260 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of Parliamentary Bureau motion 11262 on approval of an SSI. And I ask George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau to move the motion.
Moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. And I call on Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Labour will not be supporting this motion tonight, as we believe there is more work to be done to ensure that these regulations are proportionate and appropriate for children. This particular statutory instrument seeks to amend the Mental Health Safety and Security Regulations of 2005 to add Foxgrove, a new national inpatient facility for children and young people aged 12 to 17, located at the Ayrshire Central Hospital in Irvine, to the list of hospitals subject to the regulations. This statutory instrument would mean that the young patients are subject to the same measures which currently apply to adult facilities under the regulations, such as searching of patients and their belongings, sampling certain body fluid or tissue, placing restrictions and prohibiting visits, placing restrictions on the kind of things patients may have with them in hospital, and possibly confiscating items. Labour welcomes the introduction of much-needed specialist services, but we remain concerned that more work needs to be done to ensure that these regulations do not undermine the human rights of children, including those set out in the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child. In written evidence to the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee, the National Youth Justice Advisory Group said, in the quote, "They don't believe the measures should be authorised as they stand as children under 18 of different levels need and maturity." The Children and Young People's Commissioner said, and I quote, "We recommend that alternative proposals be developed using as a starting point the secure care standards and pathways." And the Centre for Mental Health and Capacity Law at Edinburgh Napier University said, and I quote, "There should be detailed human rights impact assessment undertaken in addition to this limited consultation." Indeed, Presiding Officer, consultation on this instrument lasted just 2 weeks, receiving only 9 responses, and many were unaware that it was taking place. A full children's rights and wellbeing impact assessment has not been completed. And there are legitimate concerns around consent and capacity of the patients, given both their age and varying complex needs. And while I appreciate that the Minister committed to children's rights and wellbeing impact assessment before committee last week, this should have been completed before this instrument was brought before Parliament. And on that basis, Labour will not support this instrument tonight, and I would encourage all members across the chamber to vote with us and defer this instrument until a full children's rights impact assessment and a satisfactory level of consultation with critical stakeholders has been undertaken.
Thank you, and I call on Marie Todd to respond up to 3 minutes, Minister.
Let me be clear from the start, Presiding Officer. Foxgrove is an essential service for children and young people with complex mental health needs. There is currently no other service that can meet those needs in Scotland. If these amendments are not passed, Foxgrove will be unable to maintain a safe and therapeutic hospital environment for young people who require care in a medium secure facility. I'd like to reassure members that the safety and security regulations sit within a comprehensive legal framework of the Mental Health Act, which is designed to uphold patients' rights, whilst also ensuring their safety and that of those caring for them. Of course, children and young people have different levels of need and maturity to adults and require developmentally appropriate support. I can reassure the Chamber that prior to admission and throughout their stay in Foxgrove, children and young people will be involved in supported decision-making around all aspects of their care and treatment. I've been very clear that in line with the safeguards built into the regulations and the Mental Health Act, the measures will be applied only when necessary, and they will be applied in a proportionate way that is sensitive to the developmental stage of the child or young person. The approach will be consistent with that employed for children in secure care, and in particular, the secure care standards and pathways. Patients appropriately admitted to medium secure conditions do present with significant risks to others, including staff and peers. These regulations allow the clinical staff to take proportionate measures to maintain a safe environment. There is no intent to be punitive. In the absence of these powers, it would be impossible to maintain the necessary safe, therapeutic, hospital environment needed to promote recovery. Please be assured when the measures are applied, they will uphold and protect the human rights of children and young people. In line with our commitment to the UNCRC, the regulations also allow scrutiny and oversight by the Mental Welfare Commission. Yes, I will.
Daniel Johnson.
I'm very grateful to the Minister for giving way, but surely we cannot tell whether or not these regulations will uphold those people's human rights until you've done a human rights assessment, which my colleague has just outlined that has not been carried out.
Minister.
As I explained at committee, much of the work for the human rights assessment has been completed and we are very content to complete it. We are certain that it will comply and we will provide the committee with that. With regard to the consultation, a short targeted consultation was undertaken between the 28th of September and the 12th of October. Although there were only 9 responses received, they were from key bodies that are charged with upholding human rights of children in Scotland. Now, in addition to the consultation, officials also arranged meetings with these stakeholders in order to seek further information on the responses. And from these meetings, stakeholders' discussions indicated broad support. Therefore, I think that in addition to the initial consultation, there has been a sufficient level of engagement with key individuals and organisations. Now, many of the questions that members had when I appeared before the Health and Sport and Social Care Committee related to the operational management of Foxgrove. And NHS Ayrshire and Arran, as the Commissioned Health Board, are responsible for developing operational policy. They would be pleased to welcome any interested members on a visit to Foxgrove to help to understand how it will operate and to answer any of their concerns. Presiding Officer, these regulations are an essential step in preparing for Foxgrove to admit patients, which it hopes to do in March 24, and I therefore urge members to approve these regulations.
Thank you. The question on this motion will be put at decision time. The next item of business is consideration of Parliamentary Bureau Motion 11264 on designation of a lead committee. And I ask George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm moved.
Thank you, and I call on Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Earlier this month, the Court of Session upheld an initial ruling that the legal definition of the word woman is not limited to a person of the female biological sex. This means that a trans woman with a gender recognition certificate, GRC, is given the same recognition as a biological woman in law. Current legislation allows for a trans woman to obtain a GRC if she has lived in her acquired gender for at least 2 years, is above the age of 18 and has received a suitable medical diagnosis. If the SNP Green Government had its way, the process of obtaining a GRC would be made much easier by lowering the minimum age one can apply for a certificate to 16, removing the need for a medical diagnosis and significantly reducing the time period an applicant must have lived in their acquired gender to only 3 months. Therefore, this would fundamentally change the definition of the word woman and expand who would be eligible to sit on corporate boards as a woman. Around this time last year, the UN Special Rapporteur on Violence Against Women and Girls, Reem As-Salim, wrote that the Scottish Government must, as a minimum, await the outcome of judgments on these very issues in front of both the Scottish and UK courts, including the judgment on the case of the Public Boards Act, before moving forward with the GRR Bill. My Scottish Conservative colleagues repeatedly warned the SNP Government's Gender Self-ID Bill made it significantly easier to change legal gender. Now, as a result of this latest court ruling, the SNP Government has been forced to remove the definition of the word woman from the Public Boards Act. Just like with the UNCRC Bill, we are once again having to use up parliamentary time and resources to fix another piece of poorly drafted legislation. Taxpayers have already been footed with an almost £230,000 bill for this government's legal battle to try and save this government's flawed gender self-ID bill, which is opposed by the majority of Scots. And now more time and money will be spent fixing the SNP government's latest mistake. I do hope the Scottish ministers will use this court case to finally learn their lesson. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call on Shirley Ann Somerville to respond up to 3 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Gender Representation on the Public Boards Amendment Bill aims to align the Act with the Court of Session ruling last year, which stated that its inclusion of the definition of women was out with the legislative competence of the Scottish Parliament and was therefore not law. The bill, if passed, will provide clarity by removing the redundant definition from the statute book. We have looked at all other planned legislation and did not find a suitable bill to take this forward. We appreciate that it is unusual to have such a short bill, but it is a simple, small, technical fix to the statute book. This bill does not change the policy intention of the 2018 Act. We still want boards of public bodies to better reflect the population of Scotland. The Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee was the committee which worked on the 2018 Act, and it is appropriate that they work on this bill. The thrust of the 2018 Act is an equality issue. The timetable for the Parliament's scrutiny of the bill is a matter for the Parliamentary Bureau. It is up to the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee how they scrutinise that bill. And I support the motion to refer the amendment bill to the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee.
Thank you. And the question on this motion will be put at decision time. The next item of business is consideration of four Parliamentary Bureau motions. And I ask George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move motions 11261 on approval of an SI, 11263 on approval of an SSI, 11265 on committee substitutes, and 11266 on recess dates.
All moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. The question on these motions will be put at decision time. And there are six questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first is that amendment 11247.2 in the name of Shona Robison, which seeks to amend motion 11247 in the name of Douglas Ross on independent investigation into the First Minister and Deputy First Minister be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to a vote and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access digital voting.